Oh yeah, everyone. First of all, welcome everyone. And actually, we are excited again to have you here for our second webinar of 2020. So we had one already 6 weeks ago, and this is our second one for this year. So let me spend just a few minutes reviewing our agenda and goals for this webinar for today. I'll start again with a brief introduction about myself for those who don't know me yet or are first time here for this webinar. So your speaker for the next 45 minutes, followed by a short overview about critical factors for the profitability of your VPS business. Then we'll move on to where I will spend the majority of our time here today. I'll discuss how you can grow your VPS business with simple ways of performance tuning and density increasements, and I'm going to dive deeper into maximizing revenue by maximizing density and optimizing your configuration and management operations, and which virtuoso unique features will help with that. At the end and during the session, we will have a short break for Q&A. So you notice already that there is a Q&A button on your screen. You are free to ask questions there, even through the presentation. And my colleagues and I will review them and try to respond live, either during the session or in the break and at the end of the Q&A part. And I'll ask anyone who wants to share discussion or questions live to use the raise hand button or icon next to your name, so I can unmute you during time. Okay, so let's get started. So my name is Mike Bremy. I'm user of Virtuoso technology since the early days, with 18 years hands-on experience using it for 10 years in the hosting industry. I'm driving Virtuoso product success since 10 years to eliminate its weak points with 4 years experience in cyber infrastructure appliances. And I have a special focus on combining cyber protection with virtualization to make it a perfect solution for service providers and their needs. I have a strong passion for technology and usually always looking for cool and new features which are unique and generate uniqueness to implement. Beside product management, actually I love to fix annoying bugs in open source with several years experience, and I'm the maintainer of Intel FB driver in the Linux kernel. So the purpose of this webinar is to provide you with the best practices for optimizing the performance and cost of servers running Virtuoso containers. So let me give you some insights and key facts which impact performance and density, and in the end, your revenue. What are the most critical factors? Virtuoso containers is one of the components of Virtuoso, which also includes KVM-based Virtuoso hypervisor and Virtuoso storage. So it's a bundled solution with three main components. These performance optimization tips, which I will give you during this webinar, as a result of our years of experience in providing container virtualization to our service provider partners, combined with the latest customer and VPS market research results and our most recent product improvements. So what are the most critical factors for profitability of your VPS business? First, maximizing density per server. Optimizing the number of containers deployed on each hardware node is a key way to increase infrastructure efficiency. So to ensure high quality of service for your customers, while also maximizing your profitability, you need to ensure your server configuration supports the container density and the VPS offerings you are deploying. You'll also need an understanding of the factors that influence container density in Linux environments, which I will explain during the next minutes. By following these recommendations here, you'll be able to maximize density for your servers. And second is optimizing server management and configuration. It's another key factor in building a profitable VPS business. This is hardware configuration and management. So you want to choose hardware that will ensure both high quality of service and ease of maintenance. By following our recommendations later in this session, your hardware configuration and allocated resources can significantly increase your operational efficiency. So why is maximizing density an important factor for your VPS business? So maximizing density equals to maximizing revenue. Because commercial VPS offerings are employed in many different use cases, there's no single optimal configuration. Therefore, the most important factor in managing Virtuoso servers efficiently is to match the hardware node configuration with the VPS product offering, target market, and physical environments you plan to deploy. In general, our partners have found that larger, more expensive VPS configurations typically have a higher usage level than smaller VPS configurations. That's because larger VPSs are typically purchased to support shared hosting and business critical functions, and as a result require access to all of their allocated resources a majority of the time. Rito, I will come back to this question a bit later because we have a break after half of the slides, so then I will answer it. So a smaller VPS, VPSs in contrast are typically used to support more random usage, such as software testing or less critical business applications, and therefore may only rarely need access to the maximum configured resources. So understanding how your customers use their VPS offerings will help you ensure that your VPS offerings deliver a high quality of service while also optimizing the physical resources allocated to individual containers. And second, it's about balancing quality of service and density. So one of the key benefits of Virtuoso containers is that it enables you to overcommit the physical hardware resources allocated to the server's containers. This means that on a given server, the total resources allocated to its containers may exceed the server's total hardware resources. So the result will be higher density. If managed properly, the overcommitment of resources will still deliver high level of service because resource load across all the containers on any given server is typically randomized, which means it's rare for all containers on any given server to require the maximum amount of allowable resources at the same time. Many service providers choose to overcommit their resources because the higher density they achieve helps to maximize their revenue. So what is an overcommitted system and why you should care about it? So a physical system is overcommitted for a particular resource when the hard limits for that resource across all its containers add up to more than it can deliver physically. For instance, if you have 100 containers with hard limit of 2 GB of memory assigned on a physical system, but the system has only 128 GB of memory, that system's memory is overcommitted. But as long as the actual resource usage of the container adds up to less than 128 GB, this overcommitment is only theoretical and the system will operate normally. It's only when the sum of the total resources requested by all containers on the physical node exceeds what the system can deliver. Excuse me. So in this case, the overcommitment can create problems. A system in a state that actual overcommitment will degrade the service so that each containers provide, often becoming unable to deliver your service level agreements as they become slow, laggy, unresponsive, and so on. So could you overcommit resources? And if so, when? This is one of the most important questions that your container placement policy needs to address. One possible answer is never, meaning that you will place containers on physical systems only up to the point where their resource limit adds up to the system's total capabilities. While such a policy does ensure that the containers will always deliver on your SLAs, it's likely to result in a system that is underutilized much of the time. Another possible answer is, it depends. While this is the case for most of our service providers and why they choose to overcommit their resources to some degree, this decision is hard to make. In deciding whether and how much to overcommit, you should always run analysis and simulations with realistic customer workloads to help to establish the right parameters. So, how to calculate a static overcommit and mitigate the spike usage overload problem? Static overcommit balances densities with quality of service and is easily implemented when you initially provision containers. For it to work well, however, you must have a good understanding of how customer workloads vary over the time. So the difference in container workloads when they run for a period of time, like a couple of weeks, and calculate that there will be a very low probability that the system will go into an actual overcommitted state. For example, suppose that a customer workload usually uses about 50% of its memory resource, excluding the page cache, but occasionally spikes to 100% usage for 1 minute in every hour. And suppose further that the maximum number of containers that can be placed on the system without overcommitting is 100. Because the typical utilization is 50%, you could theoretically place 200 containers on the system, have it mostly perform well. But with each application spiking for 1 minute out of 60, about 3 or 4 of the 200 containers will be spiking at any given time, so the system will always be running in an actual overcommitted state. However, if you alter your placement policy to allow up to 190 containers on the system for a static overcommit of 95%, you'll end up with room for 5 containers to spike at any given time without sending the system into an actual overcommitted state. Given that each container spikes for 1 minute in 60, we can calculate that there will be a probability at roughly 12% that 6 or more containers will spike at once, giving you an 88% probability of meeting the SLA. But that's still not good enough. If you are promising 2/9 of availability, in that case, you would reduce the static overcommit to 80%, so running 180 containers, which would put the probability of meeting the SLA at 99.7%. So these foregoing numbers are just examples, of course. To get the actual number that apply to your situation, you will need to study how your customers' workloads vary over the time and calculate what level of static overcommit you will give you a level of probability that you're still able to meet your SLAs. So how do container limits work and what can be limited? Which also comes with a variety of controllers for CPU usage, memory, disk IO, disk space, network bandwidth, and more. These controllers ensure that services in one container can't affect other containers on the same physical node. Of the various resources the controllers can manage, the most important are memory and disk IO. In most cases, services running inside containers will consume resources below their assigned limit. That's the normal case. However, should they approach or try to go over the limit, the container virtualization layer will prevent this. For instance, by pushing pages into VSwap in the case of memory limits, or by throttling disk transactions in the case of IO bandwidth limits. So, which are the most important resources to be limited? First, it's a CPU scheduler. Virtuoso CPU-related parameters include CPU units and CPU limits. These parameters both impact the CPU resources available to a container, but are not directly related to each other. So the CPU units parameter defines the weightening of CPU resources between containers. So an individual container will be able to consume up to 100% of the CPU resources if there are no other containers competing for the CPU, and you haven't defined the CPU limit parameter. If multiple containers are requesting CPU resources, then the container with a higher CPU units value will have a higher chance to have CPU resources assigned. For example, if a physical server can deliver 3,000 CPU units of computing resources and you provision two containers on the server, one with 2,000 CPU units and one with 1,000 CPU units, and both containers simultaneously request all available CPU resources, the container with 2,000 CPU units will get twice as many CPU cycles as a container with 1,000 CPU units. The CPU limit parameter defines a hard limit which controls the percentage of CPU resources a container can utilize. In establishing both of these parameters, it's important to make sure that the values you use are consistent with the number of CPUs and cores installed in the server. Second, it's about a disk I/O. So two disk I/O parameters, I/O limits and IOPS limits, exist in Virtuoso. So they provide granular and powerful controls to avoid performance degradation in situations when high disk I/O activities in one container could slow down the performance of the other containers. It's a common best practice to limit the disk throughput per container to the maximum available network bandwidth. Because majority of traffic in data centers comes through the network, and if network is limited, you can limit the disk to the same limits, just set to the same limits. However, setting a value between 10 megabytes per second, lowest limit, and 75% of the overall disk throughput upper limit will allow the physical machine to handle operations such as migration, backups, restores, and reinstallations rapidly, or cloning operations, and so on. Even if the disk I/O of a particular container begins to approach their limits. Third, memory. Virtuoso 7 uses a RHEL 7-based kernel, which includes our patch set and additional capabilities and features. And it also includes the memory managed model called VSwap that supersedes in old Virtuoso Linux versions the user bean counters. With VSwap, or with virtual swap, two primary parameters can be set. It's called fuse pages and swap pages. They let you control the amount of allocatable memory and swap space. All the other parameters, which are known from previous versions, are optional and don't need to be set anymore. So it's just to simplify parameter settings. The sum of the fuse pages and swap pages limits the maximum allocatable memory for that container. So when the fuse pages limit is reached, a memory pages belonging to that container are pushed out to the virtual swap space. Once the total amount of allocated memory is consumed, the container performance will start to degrade in this case. And fourth, it's about disk space. In high density environments, it's very important to make sure that disk quotas aren't exceeded, as exceeding them will degrade performance. Virtuoso lets you assign two types of disk quotas, one limiting the disk space for the entire container, and the other limiting the disk space available to individual users inside the container. So this is just called disk quotas. Disk space quotas for individual users, they are managed exactly in the same way as it is in a non-virtualized bare metal Linux environment. And it allows you to use existing management tools to manage these kind of quotas. So this table provides an example illustrating how you might establish different levels of overcommit for different resources. These are provided for example only. So it's only an example. It's nothing which is valid for every situation. The actual level of overcommit you configure in your system or your infrastructure depends on the factors which we have discussed on the previous slides. So let's make a short break here. I'm starting to encourage you to ask questions if you have any. So, Rito, yeah, you have a question regarding VIP. So is UEFI supported by VIP 3.5 or just BIOS boot? Actually, the answer depends on two factors of the question. So for the deployment of VIP, UEFI is supported. So you can deploy it on bare metal systems using UEFI. For virtual machines, which are running on top of VIP. Actually, I'm not the right person to ask this question because I'm not 100% sure if it's supported or not. Might be, but I need to clarify it. But for the physical nodes, they will work with UEFI. So when you deploy VIP on top of bare metal system. Guys, any other questions? You can also write them if. So I will just read them and answer them. No more questions? Well, actually, in this case, I will continue. So, which Virtuoso technology will help you in increasing density? It's about memory and IOPS application. So, Virtuoso collect file usage statistics in real time to determine which files are most frequently accessed by containers and puts commonly used files in a cache. That way, if a container needs to access a commonly used file, it can go straight to the cache instead of the disk. And this is an approach that improves performance by reducing the number of I/O operations. And for even better performance, this cache can be placed on a solid state drive and be decoupled from the physical disks where you store the container data. The benefits of this approach to DDoP application are the following. So first of all, it's reliable and robust since it removes the needs to download old templates, which may no longer be available and so on in order to restore older versions of containers. Second, it's configurable with the ability to apply parameters to specify factors such as cache size, directories to be cached, you can exclude files, expiration time of cached files, and so on, and the caching strategy. Third, it's always up to date because the daemon that tracks file access ensures that the cache always has the most frequently accessed data in the cache and removes non-frequently accessed data automatically. And lastly, it's easy to keep it at the top performance. It comes with a configuration tool that lets you modify various options to enhance performance. So just as I mentioned, define the cache policy and so on. And next technology, which will help you to improve memory efficiency by using Virtuoso templates. A template or a package set in Virtuoso is a set of original application files repackaged for rapid container creation. Using templates within containers, it can greatly improve the efficiency of server memory utilization. Virtuoso provides tools for creating templates, installing them, upgrading them, adding them to container, and removing them from a container. So using templates lets you first share RAM among or share memory among similar applications running in different containers, saving hundreds of megabytes of memory. And second, share the files that makes up a template among different containers, saving gigabytes of disk space. And third, reducing IOPS by allowing containers which access the same file from a template to read it only one time from the disk and then allow all other containers to access it from memory. And Virtuoso has two types of templates. First, it are operating systems, so-called OS templates. They consist of an operating system plus a standard set of installation applications, like systemd, like secure shell, and so on. Virtuoso uses operating system templates to create new containers with a pre-installed operating system. And second template type are application templates, which consist of a set of repackaged software packages, optionally accompanied by configuration scripts and so on. Virtuoso uses application templates to add extra software to an existing operating system container. For example, you can create a container on the basis of CentOS 7 operating system template and later add MySQL to it using an application template. Let's return back to our two main areas in which Virtuoso helps to maximize revenue. So the second part is how to optimize your server environment and configuration and management operations. So providing customers with reliable service, which means an absolute minimum of service disruptions, is one of the most important factors in service provider success. At the same time, to enhance profitability, you have to minimize your maintenance costs. Achieving both goals can be very difficult, but not when you use Virtuoso. The following is a best practice which will help you to ensure high quality of service while also enhancing your profitability. So first, it's about optimize your environment. So key steps which can be taken to do so include the following. Using compatible operating system environments on your host machine. For example, deploying Virtuoso. It ensures optimum performance and reliability for containers, virtual machines, and additional services on top of it. Using the same hardware in all your nodes, including disk controllers and other peripherals. It will reduce the risk of driver-related problems. Avoiding the use of third-party drivers on any of your nodes. In our experience, many third-party drivers have not been validated across all the variations of hardware and software that can be deployed on a machine and therefore can negatively affect system reliability. Keeping all configurations synchronized across all your Virtuoso servers to simplify troubleshooting and maintenance. And second, it's about streamlining deployment. Virtuoso streamlines deployment by enabling you to use a single disk to deploy the complete software stack, including the operating system and containers, on a bare metal server. This approach not only speeds up installation, but also improves reliability by ensuring that all machines are configured consistently. Virtuoso also lets you provide virtual machines for those customers that want to maintain their own operating system on the server. And of course, you can streamline deployment by rapid, unattended, automatic network-based installations. In this case, you need to use Virtuoso and integrate it into commonly used Pixieboot environment. With Pixieboot, you can rapidly deploy Virtuoso nodes in a very short time. And third, it's about reducing the impact of disk failures. Hard drive failures are typically the most unreliable, or hard drives are typically the most unreliable server component. So using hot plug compatible disk space and battery backed up RAID controllers will reduce the impact of hard drive failures. Also, one important factor, try to avoid using controllers which have an active fan, because active fan significantly decreases reliability of a RAID controller. And when they fail, they can generate data failures because controller becomes too hot and so on. And fourth, it's about optimize your hard drive configuration. For example, you should configure the swap space to a resource level which meets your overcommitment strategy and so on. So many different VPS configurations are deployed in the market. And no one configuration, price infrastructure, or service level is appropriate for every application and situation. Here you see a few real-world examples from our service provider partners, illustrating the wide range of options, hardware sizes, and densities that can be effectively deployed with Virtuoso. A small VPS configuration achieves very high density with a high level of service, by carefully managing and monitoring resource usage on the server. The large VPS configuration achieves lower VPS densities, but still requires careful management of overcommitted resources, just to ensure the high level, high quality of service. And the third configuration is unique in that it allows customers to deploy as many VPS instances as they like without a per container fee and charging instead based on total memory usage across all the containers. So let's move on to the optimization checklist. It will help you to optimize your newly deployed Virtuoso infrastructure and maximize density. So whenever you deploy new Virtuoso nodes or a cluster of nodes, verify the following. Have you set your CPU limit, disk IO limit, and memory parameters appropriately to match your VPS offerings, your container workloads, and the physical capacity of the server? Have you limited disk throughput per container and aligned it with your network bandwidth? Have you set the disk space and network I/O appropriately for your environment, so not to overcommit disks by disk space by factor 100 or something like that? Have you documented your level of overcommitment and mapped it to your specific hardware? It's important to document and to monitor overcommitment level, because with any overcommitment, you may run in situation when the system starts to degrade performance. Have you set up the necessary tools, that's what I've mentioned already, for monitoring resources and usage of these resources? And of course, have you reached customers which constantly hit their allocated limits and upsold them additional resources? It is some kind of customer satisfaction. So if a VPS hits quite often their limits, customer satisfaction is usually bad, because customer asks for why my VPS is slow, my applications doesn't start, and so on. So those customers should be upsold to a higher VPS offering. And have you minimized driver-related problems by using the same hardware in all nodes? And do you streamline your deployment and automate it as much as possible with Pixieboot environments? And have you optimized hard drive configuration and swap levels in accordance with our best practices? And have you set appropriate swap space for your memory levels? So if you use VSwap, for example, and 1/3 of the space is allocated to VSwap, you said you should create a swap partition which has the proper size for it to keep all the data in swap. And have you implemented clustering with Virtuoso storage, for example, to improve reliability and add high performance services and high available services on top of it? Let's go to the key takeaways for today. So key takeaways are the following. Using virtual swap to maximize container performance. Containers for Linux using I/O limits to maximize container performance and to reduce the noisy neighbor situations. Following the best practices for optimizing your Linux VPS and cloud server infrastructure. And of course, using either Intel Optane SSDs or other PCI Express or NVMe SSDs to accelerate performance of containers and virtual machines. Actually, you will find white papers with a lot of detailed explanations and configuration steps on our website for all these topics. So basically, that's it for the webinar, for my presentation. And now we have a period of time for Q&A. So I'm waiting for your questions.
So yeah, and now I got a question. In Zoom there are two screens for questions. One was in the chat and one is the Q&A. Well, Julian, actually, this happens when all the containers do it simultaneously. Because if you limit the IOPS and the IO bandwidth inside the container, there's always room for the physical node to use it. But of course, if all containers simultaneously start to utilize this IO, then they have the same priority as a host node, and they will reduce the performance of the node itself. But even if we would give the node a higher priority, it's more like a wait. They will still fight for the resources. And that's why it's probably better to define a hard limit and try to ensure that not all the containers at the same time, so IOPS and IO is also an overcommitted resource, and not utilize all the IO bandwidth or IOPS simultaneously. So you can also type your questions now in chat, not only in this Q&A with the raise hand icon. How does a VMMD, a policy of performance, affect overcommitment of memory? Well, there are two strategies for VMMD to follow these memory overcommitments. So actually, in default scenario, when you leave it as is and start containers, it will, first of all, when you run out of memory and out of swap, it will kill applications which are at this time requesting additional memory. So the application which wants some memory and there's no memory left and no swap gets an OOM, so out of memory condition. And for the VMMD, it depends in Virtuoso 7 a bit how vSwap is configured, or virtual swap. So when you assign first pages like 2 gigabyte and 1 gigabyte virtual swap, you need really 1 gigabyte physical swap memory. Because in this case, swap goes directly to swap. It not goes to memory first, even if there is free memory. If you have a node with 4 gig of memory, 2 gig assigned to a container with 1 gig swap pages, this 1 gig will never go to the memory. It will straight go to the swap space. Here, actually, you should configure it in this case then differently. If you want to use memory with overcommitment, you should assign only the 3 gig of memory to the container with physical pages and let the kernel decide when it starts swapping pages out to the swap space. In this case, kernel has some a smart mechanism, I would say, or some algorithm to decide what to swap, which page to swap out, and what to do in case of out of memory situations. A VMMD is really more about the strategy, how it behaves when it runs out of memory. Okay, there's another question from Maximilian. Hi, Maximilian. How does Virtuoso 7 work with Intel Optane DC modules? Does it behave the same as with DRAM only? This might even allow lower over-provisioning or minimize it to zero. Well, actually, it depends what you put on site this Intel Optane SSD. If you put VZ on it, I mean the VZ partition, and create containers with plook images, with sparse images on it, you can overcommit as you want, or as you know from physical disks or from an SSD. But it's probably not the best way. That's why we have this white paper where it's explained in detail. Actually, I would encourage you to go to our website and download it and read it. That's explained in very in a lot of details how Intel Optane SSDs work with Virtuoso together. We have a separate paper for it, Maximilian. Okay, regarding these Intel Optanes, Maximilian, actually we need to check because they are much newer. So I don't know from my mind if we have tested it currently with Virtuoso 7. So I need to follow up on it later because you have my contact details. They are on the next slide anyway. So let's follow up on this after the call or after the webinar. And we will take it from there. There's a question from Julian. Do you know of situations in which OEMs occur, even if not all RAM is committed to VEs? Is there a practice with the VCMMD density mode or other limits we should consider? Actually, Julian, yes, there is one situation in Virtuoso 7. It's different from Virtuoso 6. When you have a container and it has as I've mentioned, it has 2 GB of memory assigned and 1 GB swap pages. And you don't have enough free swap space anymore, but you still have enough memory. This container runs in OEM situation because when it starts to use, imagine it has utilized all its 2 GB of memory and requests more. The next, after this 2 GB would immediately go to the swap pages. And in Virtuoso 7, we really use the swap pages from the physical swap. In Virtuoso 6, it was also used for memory, and it was basically not correct swap implementation. But in Virtuoso 7, we will use swap from swap. And if you don't have any free swap anymore, a container will run into OEM situation, even if the physical host has free physical memory. But it's because you forced the container to use swap. And actually, to avoid it, the only thing is to set swap pages to 0, set the physical pages to the old value of first pages plus swap pages, and let the kernel decide when to swap data. So yeah, this is one example when you can run an OEM situation in a container, even if the physical node still shows it has enough physical memory. It's because swap is full. In BC7, deadline IO scheduler is used, and we observe that this scheduler performs better than CFQ for IO intense workloads on single containers, but it also leads to high IO weight if multiple containers perform IO intense workloads. Do you propose setting IOPS limit for all containers in VZ7? Well, actually, it depends. The answer is like so many answers, even in the webinar, it depends. In general, you should set IOPS limits in the situation when you observe these kind of problems, like you have high IO wait times and when running multiple containers and multiple containers try to consume a lot of IOPS or a lot of IO benefits, then you should start setting it on all containers on this node. Because just setting it on some containers will not help. Actually, it will limit these containers, but the overall system is still degrading performance because the rest of the containers are used too much. So in general, when you start your offering or start creating containers, there's no need to set it. But when there's a certain point reached when IO performance degradation starts, you should set it on all containers on this node, not only on particular ones. So, any other questions? Actually, Julian, okay, thanks. We have swap in the virtual environment disabled, but sometimes see that swap in the node is used before OM starts. Is it an issue if we have no swap? Well, actually, if you have no swap, I mean, physically not assigned, you should never use, never for no container, swap pages in Virtuoso 7, because in Virtuoso 7, it requires real swap. In Virtuoso 6, it was different. So this is important. For example, if you migrate containers from Virtuoso 6 to Virtuoso 7, please ensure if you don't have swap on the physical node that these containers don't use swap pages. Otherwise, it can lead to the situation which you have described. So if no more questions, and then I will close this webinar now. And thanks for everyone who has participated. And basically, if you have questions or comments, you can always reach me at my mail address, which is available here. And even if you have questions which you forgot to ask now, you can just raise them afterwards and we can take it from there. So thanks for the time, everybody, today. And actually, nowadays, we need to say it, stay healthy and stay home. And let's start for the next or wait for the next webinar, which we will hold in a couple of weeks or in 1.5 months. So thanks, everyone. And bye-bye.